All right, so you should be familiar with several names for the regression line. Sometimes it's called the least squares line, the line of best fit, the regression line. All of these are names for this line that we find to model our linear data. And I want to tell you why it is the line that models our data and maybe explain this first name. Why is this line the best line for our data? So suppose we have some data. All right, and then we're trying to find a line that we think will best fit our data. Okay, so let's say this is the line that I come up with. Okay, well, notice that some points fall above the line and some points fall below the line. So there are two things. When we have a particular value, it has an x and a y coordinate. Okay, but so let's put the x coordinates here. And of course, the y's are measured along here. So y represents the actual y value of an observed data point. Okay, but at this same x value, we have what is called a predicted y value. And this is what we call y hat. Remember when I wrote the regression equation earlier, I didn't say y equals, we called it y hat. Y hat represents the predicted value of y based on our model. Okay? For this particular model, in any model, the difference between the observed value and the predicted value is called the residual. Okay? And so for all of these points, we have residuals. Okay, here's the residual for this point. Here's one for him. Residuals. All of these residuals. Okay, the difference between the observed y value and the predicted y value. Okay, and if we add these residuals up, they actually come up to zero. If the line is any good, it's going to go through the point x bar, y bar. And so we kind of pivot the line to figure out which line is the best line. We get all of these residuals. Okay, when we add up the residuals, they add up to zero. So, like we did when we were trying to find the standard deviation, we're going to square the residuals so that when we add those squared residuals up, they don't add up to zero. Okay, and so how do we decide which line is the best line? We say that the line of best fit is the line that minimizes the sum of the squared residuals. Okay, so we want the line, we can't just say the line that has the least amount of residual because the residual is going to add up to be zero, but it has the least amount of squared residual. Okay, so that's what you need to know about this line. Why is this the best line? Because it's the line that minimizes the sum of the squared residuals. And by using the formulas that lead to the regression equation, whether you're doing it by hand or on the calculator, you get the line of best fit, okay, or the line that minimizes the sum of the squared residuals. Okay, so we're going to go through another example pretty quickly, just to kind of recap everything that we talked about. There's not really a lot to do, and hopefully you'll be able to learn these things quickly and be able to have a lot of success on the test. So here we have a set of data that I collected. My gas tank on my vehicle was broken for quite some time, and so I just figured I could make a math model to help me figure out when I need to get gas, or whatever. So, but the way that we're going to use this is we're going to look at miles, and we're going to use that to predict the number of gallons of gas needed, which I think is what most folks would probably kind of be looking at. But anyway, the first thing I want to do is prepare a scatter diagram of the data. Okay, so I'm going to put this in my calculator. And to do that, we went to Stat, Edit. Okay, so I've got my data in, and of course, it's always worth taking a second to go back through the data and make sure that you've not made any errors. If you've looked at the formulas for calculating the correlation coefficient or the coefficients for our model, the A and B for our model, those formulas are really time intensive if we had to do it by hand. So just take a second and make sure that you don't have any errors in your data so that you'll come up with the right answers. Okay, so now I want to do a scatter plot. I can still use the same stat plot that I had before, but I've got to change where my data is. This time I put my data in L3 and L4. I put my gallons of gas in L3, and I put my miles in L4. So I want miles to be my independent variable. So my X list is going to be L4, and my Y list is going to be L3. Okay, and so now, I'm going to turn off. I had on an equation earlier on my Y equals list. I want to turn that off so I can hop on the equal sign and hit enter to turn it off if I don't want to clear it out. And now I'll go ahead and hit graph. Okay, again, we don't see any data, but that's okay. We'll just hit zoom and number 9 to have the calculator adjust the window for statistical data. And when I look at this, I see pretty clearly that there looks like a linear pattern amongst the data. So that allows me to go on to the next step, which is to find the correlation coefficient. So to do that, we went to Stat, Calc. We're going to do number 4, which is linear regression. I need to tell it where my X values are first. So I put my X values, miles, in L4, and my Y values are in L3. And enter. Okay, so the correlation coefficient is 0.92. So we can say there's a strong linear relationship between miles driven and gallons of gas used. Okay, which of course we probably expected we would see that. All right, so now I'm ready to make a prediction. I've got to first, of course, come up with my model. And in this case, my model is going to be y hat equals 0.077x minus 6.29. Okay, so if I want to make a prediction about 250 miles, then I could just do it by hand on the calculator, or if I wanted to, I could put this function on my Y equals list. So I'll do that since I've got to make a couple of predictions. To do this, I'll clear out that last function we had. I'm going to go to vars. Number 5 is statistics. We can go over to equation. And the first option there is regression equation. So there's my model. To use the model, I'm going to go to vars, over to yvars. Number 1 is function. And we've got y1, I want to evaluate at 250 miles. So in order to drive 250 miles, I'm going to need about 12.8 gallons of gas. Now, if I wanted to drive 400 miles, then recalling the data that I have, I'm going to go back and look and see if that's near the observed values for my miles driven. And when I look at it, 400 is a good little ways outside of the model. And so what I would say for 400 miles is that this model is not appropriate to make a prediction for 400 miles. Okay, so that's what you should say for that one. Okay, if I wanted to interpret the slope of the regression model, okay, looking back at our slope, okay, we had a slope of 0.07. So I would say for each additional mile, it requires 0.077 gallons of gas to drive. Okay. And then if I wanted to talk about the intercept, in this case, we'd say if we drive 0 miles, then it requires negative 6.29 gallons of gas. Of course, that doesn't make sense, you know, and if we look back at our data, we would see that 0 is very far outside of the range of observed values. So the model is not appropriate to make a prediction there, and our intercept has no practical interpretation in this particular example. Okay. All right, so I interpreted the slope and the intercept. And now I can say, what percent of variation in gallons of gasoline is explained by miles driven? And so again, that's given to us on the calculator by the R squared value. So we can say 85% of the variation in gallons of gas consumed by our vehicle is explained by miles driven. Okay, 15% of the variation is left unexplained. And so there might be a couple of things that might improve the model, but 15% is not a huge amount of unexplained variation. You know, depending on all kinds of things, you know, it could be temperature one day, it could be the amount of time that you spend in traffic another day, it could be whether or not you're driving highway miles or city miles, all kinds of things. So we'd probably leave this model exactly where it was. But the main point that you need to understand is that 85% of the variation in gasoline consumption is explained by miles driven, and about 15% is left unexplained.